Everybody, I Neeraj, on the behalf of Over and Out organization, I welcome you all on the auspicious day of World Environment Day. The theme of this year is It's Time for Nature. Yes, it is. Nature can fulfill all your need, but can't fulfill all your greed, said by Mahatma Gandhi. As we are continuously degrading our natural resources to fulfill our need and made our livelihood painlessly, which resulted in complete degradation of environment. So we can fix it now, we can act now. Therefore, in the pandemic situation, we can try to fix it if we act now. Therefore, in the COVID-19 and pandemic situation, we have to do something productive and spreading awareness among local people about various environmental issues. We have renowned speaker, Dr. Sanjita Pokhriyal, sent by us. She is present to give a webinar on the topic, A Journey to the Elephant Land. Dr. Sanjita Pokhriyal mainly works on Asian elephant. The core theme of her research revolves around elephant ecology, conservation, physiology, and wildlife endocrinology. She had done her graduation from Sri Bhavan University and master's from Kurukshetra University, Kurukshetra. And she has done her PhD from IISc Bangalore. And right now she is doing a postdoc in IISc. Before handling mic to ma'am, I would like to share something about Over and Out organization. Where a small group of youngsters like me and my friend teammates starting this organization 1.5 years back, where we are doing some field work now. But now, at the time of pandemic, we started the mainly focus out on online based work, like creating webinar, organized webinar, which creating awareness among people. So we have a strong network of environmentalists, teachers, students, scientists, along with the many people who are come from different disciplines. And now that time, with my friend from Kurukshetra University, Kurukshetra, starting joining this initiative with me. And now several volunteers from all over India are joining our NGO and starting doing the webinar work. So taking no longer your time, I would like to call Dr. Sanjita Pokhriyal.
Yeah, sure.
Yes,
sir. Okay. Thank you, Neeraj, and also Ritik for inviting me to join your initiative. I feel really happy, and you know, I'm more happy because I am going to talk to it's really close to my heart and also academic life, the Kurukshetra University, and also I'm happy to talk to many of you junior whom I have never met, but you know, I'm really happy that you guys also know about me. And so right now I'm in Mudumalai National Park. So, and inside the forest area, Tamil Nadu. And that's the reason we have a very poor internet connection. So with that, I just want to request you guys that, you know, I'll be switching off my video and my microphone will be on before I start the presentation. And so let's get it started about, so I hope that you guys will really like this journey to elephants. Elephant land, in fact.
Sure. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Give me some time. I may take some time to, you know, switch on the, sharing the presentation. So just bear with me.
Yes, ma'am.
So once I start sharing my presentation, I won't be able to see you guys. And if you guys have any question regarding my presentation or any queries regarding science or elephants, you can just post your comments or, you know, questions to chat box. And I think Neeraj and Ritik will later on talk about it. And uh-huh. For the presentation, I'm going to talk for around half an hour. And if you have any queries in between, you just keep on noting down your questions. And after half an hour, we can have a, you know, session where we can just discuss about elephant science or general question that you guys have in your mind. So here I'm sharing the presentation. Are you guys able to see?
Yes, ma'am.
Awesome. I hope everyone is able to see. They can just post a comment on chat box. Okay, guys. Good evening to you, all of you guys. I hope you are having wonderful time during lockdown. I know the situation in India and all around the world is not good, but still, I hope, you know, we are doing something to bring down this COVID-19 infection and things. And one more minute. Ritik, Neeraj, you wanted to record it, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, there is options of recording if you want to record.
Neeraj?
Yes, Ritik. Yes, Ritik. Yes, it is on.
Okay.
So thanks. I want to thank Neeraj and also Ritik. Neeraj particularly, because he was the one who's been sending me email and he wanted me to be the part of this webinar. And I really am happy that, you know, you guys have started such an organization and you are spreading some kind of awareness about environment. It is actually needed in the current situation. And also I'm happy, you know, through this webinar, I'm happy that I'm talking to my juniors from my alma mater, Kurukshetra University, and that gives me more happiness. And I was really excited. I have given many talks all over the world, but, you know, this talk in particular is very special to me because after 10 years, I'm talking to Kurukshetra University and my juniors there. So without making you guys wait, I just want to tell you guys that, you know, what exactly is the thing that inspired most of the scientists, okay, particularly in the field of science, or what is the thing, you know, how to do science, or how you can do something or contribute your knowledge towards science. So there are ways of doing it. So first thing is questions. So if you see many scientists, you might be, you know, observing them. So they have certain kind of questions in their mind. They will be thinking why things are happening, how things are happening, and what is that thing which is happening in the current situation or something like that. And this is one quality that Indian Institute of Science taught me, that how, you know, questioning is very important in science. You should have lots of questions in your mind, and that's where if you have questions, then you can do many things in science. So even when you talk about questions, there are, again, there are types of questions. Like I said, proximate questions. Proximate questions are what is science, or what is particular phenomena, and how that phenomena is happening. And there is another question, ultimate questions is like, or it is also known as ultimate causation, that why things are happening. So I want to give you an example, like proximate is like elephant has trunk, right? So what is trunk? What is trunk of the elephant? And how trunk formation happened, that how trunk is formed in elephant. And then now ultimate question is why elephant need a trunk? So, you know, such kind of question, if you guys start thinking about any phenomena that you see in your nature or in around you, then that's also, you know, part of a science. That's how science begin. And so particularly in science, when I'm talking about science, I'm referring to wildlife science. Other than question, there is tools or mode. Mode is like, you know, methods. There are ways of doing science, like somebody does genetic analysis, somebody builds a camera trap, and using that camera trap, they will, you know, survey the animals around the forest. So that is a tool. That is also one mode of science. That is also, you know, one way of doing science. And another part of wildlife science is animals. Sometimes it is animals that inspire you to do, like turtles, small mammals, dolphins, and in my case is elephant. So what exactly inspired me to take wildlife science was elephant. So elephants are always special to me, and that's where, you know, I thought I should do something to elephants, and that's where I developed proximate causation, and that problem I wanted to address proximate questions, and then I use many other tools which I'll be talking to you guys about. So with this, I want to start my, when Neeraj said what topic you want to discuss about, I said I want to talk about journey to the elephant land, my journey, that where how I started, well, how I came to India and how I started my work and so on and so forth. I'll be discussing with you guys. So to introduce to you guys my academic introduction, I'm actually from Nepal. And I did BSc in Environmental Science from Tribhuvan University. And during my BSc, I was very curious, and I used to do different project in one of the national park in Nepal, which is quite close to my hometown. And after I completed my BSc in Environmental Science, Government of India and Indian Council of Cultural Relationship, they gave me one of the prestigious fellowship through which I came to India. And that's where my journey to India started. And that's where, my journey, my love for Indian forest started. And I saw, my passion that I should actually continue my work in India because I was so connected to the animals found in India. So when I got the fellowship, I got my enrollment in Kurukshetra University. I never knew about that university before because in Nepal, only JNU, Delhi University are famous. But, Kurukshetra University in the field of wildlife was not known to me. But when I came to Kurukshetra University and joined university, I realized that, actually university is good. And also you guys should remember that it's not the university that makes you a great person. It is a passion and your question that you have in your mind, that dream that you want to pursue in your life, that is what makes you great. So taking you guys through university, my Kurukshetra University time, I joined Kurukshetra University in August 2008. And when I joined immediately, I was so mesmerized by the beauty of Kurukshetra University. We have lots of greeneries around. And in addition, we have that lake and around the campus. And we used to just go, my friend, I have a bunch of friends who are as enthusiastic as me. So we used to go around. And the initial days only, we started bird watching in campus. We made a list of birds found in campus. So, something was there that we always wanted to do something for environment. And also organize many kind of campaigns in Kurukshetra University and also the villages in near our university, like Pipli, Karnal, and all these areas we used to go and spread awareness about environment. We were quite young like you guys, but that somehow that built up the confidence in us and also built up one path that we should go towards wildlife science, do something for wildlife. It got fueled when me and one of my colleagues, Shubhi Malik from same Institute of Environmental Studies, we go, as a part of our master course, we went to Wildlife Institute of India around, I think, 2009. So we did our internship there and we... One month in the place there was not even a single human being. So we were working in high alpine meadow of India. It's Oli Bugyal, Garso Bugyal of Uttarakhand. So I was working on birds and my colleague, she was working on butterfly. And that's where, our interest to be inside the wild, that, staying where there is no water, no food, and there was not even a house, proper house. So that actually that gave us more enthusiasm to work on in the field of wildlife science. And moreover, the faculties in Institute of Environmental Studies, they were so friendly. They used to, and also other faculties, all of them, WWF Nepal. And the main, so I was paid minimal because I joined as an intern. And but my motto was to learn something, so I did not care about the pay scale. And in WWF, I learned about various conservation programs. And I was working on gharials, Gavialis gangeticus. And that's where, insight of, and also asking questions, that characteristic of asking questions started, because I started studying the ecology of gharials in the river, major river basins of in Nepal, and also did various kind of awareness campaigns. So it was kind of full package for me to, you know, learn that how conservation programs are managed on the ground. And I am really indebted for WWF Nepal for giving that opportunity to me. So once I completed, so when I was doing my work, I got selected in US for my PhD, and also in India. So there were two offers for me to do PhD, either in US or in India, Indian Institute of Science. Since because I was working in India and I knew that how diverse forests are in India, and then how many questions are there in the forest that we can address, I ignored the US scholarship and came back to IISc again to India, and that's where my journey to Elephant Land started. In between, you know, in between this journey, I was actually, you know, it's called positive reinforcement. I got several rewards for some of the good work that I did, and one of the rewards that actually motivated more to me to, you know, stick to my dream of following elephants was the award that that was given by government of Nepal, the president of Nepal, Nepal Vidya Bhushan. It's like a prestigious civilian award, which is quite equivalent to Padma Bhushan in India. So I was really lucky to get that, and I want to dedicate that reward to elephants of India, because they were the one who actually inspired me. With this, I would like to start, you know, I selfishly want to take this opportunity to talk about elephants to you guys, because whenever I get opportunity, I think that everyone around us should know about elephants and also other animals, because animal needs us. Are you guys with me right now? I just want to confirm, or I'm just talking to myself. Niraj, Ritik, are you guys here?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so I'm not talking to myself, right? I just wanted to confirm that.
Yes, ma'am.
So, all right. So I wanted to post question to you guys and ask, you know, what comes in your mind when you think about elephant. But since this is not an interactive session, so I just want to tell you guys that what comes in my mind when I think about elephants. Being from Nepal and also working in India, which is like majority of people, you guys, there are Hinduism. So in Hinduism, there is Lord Ganesha. And whenever we talk about elephant, the first thing that comes in my mind is Lord Ganesha. Lord Ganesha is Lord of prosperity, wisdom, and happiness. And, you know, elephants in the wild are no less than Ganesha, because they are highly intelligent animals. You guys are also able to hear me, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Mm.
So I was here, right? I was talking about elephants.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so that's what elephants are highly, like I was saying, that they were very intelligent. They are very intelligent animal, and they have good sense of empathy. Science has proven it, and also there are many anecdotes. So sharing with you guys one of the anecdote, which is from actually, are you guys, so there's no problem with my voice, right? Niraj?
Yes, ma'am, there is no problem.
Okay, awesome. So sharing with you guys, you know, one of the anecdote from Thailand, where elephant to keep a pit, wooden log inside the pit, and elephant happily was following the instruction. But however, in one case, elephant denied in retreat. Back. So Mahout was really curious that why such thing is happening. So when Mahout went closer to the pit and found that there was a dog sleeping it on inside the pit. So, you know, elephants, this is one of the anecdotes, and there are now some of the scientific documentation that elephant actually have compassion or feeling towards other animal, also to their, they have a very good intelligence. And what makes elephant different than other herbivore or large mammal is their trunk. You guys might have noticed that, you know, elephants have used trunk and other animals do not have trunk. And why is it so? Because this trunk, you know, is a muscular flexible extension of upper lip and nose. It's really interesting. They apparently, for the trunk, 40 to 50,000 muscles are required to build up a trunk. And the function of trunk is multiple. They are highly sensitive, and also, you know, they are highly dexterous. When I say dexterous, they can even pick up the needle, like small thing like needle and a flower from the ground. And also and sensitive, when I say sensitive, it's they use trunk for smelling, which is also known as olfaction. And they also use for multi-purpose, like holding water, around 8 to 10 liters of water in the trunk, and so on forth. And this makes elephant unique than other animal. When I'm talking to you guys about elephants, what I'm interested, you know, in is a story 38 million years ago. If you see the ancestor of elephant, which is also called Merytherium, 38 million years ago, they did not have trunk, but they had prehensile mouth, and they were of size act as equivalent to pig. So it is really interesting to see that elephant evolved in the due course of time from a pig-like creature to the mighty elephants. Though if in the screen you can see many types of elephants, but recently in the world we have only two kind of elephants, Asian elephants and African elephants. So these are the only living elephants that we have right now. So talking about the Asian elephants and African elephants, like in this picture you guys can see, African elephants are quite bigger in size, and whereas Asian elephants are smaller in size. And there are many other differences, like their, you know, ear pattern. If you see the ear patterns, it is quite different. It's quite bigger in African elephant and quite smaller in Asian elephants. And their tip of the tongue has only one finger in Asian elephants, whereas they have two fingers in African elephants. There is height wise difference, there is weight wise difference. Also there is behavior habitat wise different in both of these individuals. And you know, there are two subspecies of African elephants. In scientific term, African elephants are known as Loxodonta africana. So there are elephants which lives in forest of Africa. They are called forest African elephants, and those who lives in savanna, in the grassland, are called savanna. In case of Asian elephants, we have three subspecies of elephants. One is Sumatran elephant, Sri Lankan elephants, and Indian elephant. Indian elephant is the one which you guys see when you go to Rajaji. You guys might have seen when you go towards Rajaji National Park, or if you guys have traveled down south, you guys have traveled to Tamil Nadu or Bandipur, you'll see lots of elephant, you know, crossing the roads. So those are Indian elephants, and the scientific name for Asian elephant is Elephas maximus. So let's focus on Elephas maximus, because these are the elephants that are found in our country, in our southern Asian country. So talking about Asian female, so one difference I did not say here about the elephants is, if you can closely observe the African elephant, both male and female have tusk, you can see this extension of teeth. But in case of Asian elephants, only male elephant will have tusk. A female elephant do not have tusk. But even in male, there are two kind of variants. There are two kind of males. Male who have tusk are known as tuskers, and male who do not have tusk is known as makhana. So we have two kind of male. It's really interesting to see that why such evolution happened, that, you know, many times when I'm walking in forest and also in human dominated landscape, I get a call saying that, madam, there is female elephant in my backyard, and please come and see. And when I go there, it's not a female elephant, it's a male elephant without tusk, which we call them as makhana. So talking about, like when I started the presentation, I said that Asian elephants are highly intelligent. They have a strong social bonding. They have a family, and you know, the family is matriarchal society. So society in elephants are matriarchal because it's mostly females who are in family. So the basic family unit in Asian elephants start with a mother and a calf. Mother and calf come together to form, you know, family, which is where there are sisters, their calves coming together. If you guys have observed a group of elephants, 6 or 7, while you guys are in Rajaji or nearby national park. And this elephant come together to form bone group, and occasionally and seasonally, you can see large number of elephants coming together, and around 100, 200 elephants. These elephants group is known as clan, and it is occasional or sometimes seasonal. So in this picture, you can see I captured this picture in Kabini backwater of Nagar Hole National Park, and there were around 100 elephants. It's just that, in this picture, I could not capture all of them because they were highly dispersed, but they were on the ground there. And all the picture that I have used is from my field work during in Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. So now the society in elephant is called fission-fusion type of society, because they come together when resources are limited and they again disperse. And that's the reason it's called fission-fusion type of society and it's matriarchal society, because they are most of the females. Then what happens to male? Well, talking about the male in elephants, once they get sexual maturity, imagine around the age of 10 to 15, they leave their herd and they remain solitary throughout their life. In this picture, you can see Kabini, and on the other side, the trees and all this area is Bandipur National Park. So Bandipur National Park and Nagar Hole National Park are quite close to each other. And this Makhna, this is again a male elephant. You guys may think, oh, it's a female, but it's male elephant. And Makhna, I took this picture around 2015 when I was working in Kabini. And so that's what the male elephants in Asian elephants are always solitary. They form occasional group, but it is not permanent. It's like temporary groups during seasonally or occasionally they form a group, which is also known as bachelor group. So talking about reproductive maturity, okay, in case of Asian elephants, female elephants, when they are sexually active, that phase is called estrus. It is, the window is of around 16 to 18 weeks. Interesting behavior is of male. The sexual mature phase in male is called must. So if you guys have happened to go to wild, and if you guys have seen elephant, you can see, if the male is in must or is sexually active, you can see the temporal gland. It's the temporal gland here. It will be swollen and there will be secretion. This secretion is temporine pheromone. It's kind of signal, it acts as a signal to female about the sexual phase of that male. So then female would know that this male is sexually active. So this is called must in males. And many times people ask that, must elephants are aggressive. Yes, there is little bit of behavioral change when they get must, but must elephants are aggressive when they are in captivity, because during must they tend to roam around freely in search of female. But in captivity, they are actually chained and, they can't move around. And that's what actually causes more change in behavior, and they become more aggressive. So once they mate, elephant can give birth to a single calf, and the calf intercalving period is 4 to 5 years, and gestation period is 22 to 23 months. That in human it's 9 months, and in elephants it's almost 2 years. And an elephant is active, she can give birth till she is 50 years, then there will be reproductive senescence. So with this, how do elephants communicate? It's really fascinating. Elephant communicate with tactile signal. They generally, if you guys have observed wild elephant in the forest, they will start entangling their trunk and touching the head of another elephant with their trunk. And they do acoustic signaling, where they use lots of vocalization, and also they use chemical signal, like I said about must, where they secrete temporine gland and temporine horn pheromone, and also so urine dribbling to signal other females about his reproductive state. So there are multiple way of communication in elephants. And so why it is important for us to study elephant? Why it was important for me to study elephant? Well, that elephant, I'm pretty sure you guys know about this. Elephants are called umbrella species, because saving one elephant, you are going to save multiple species in that forest, be it small mammals or there are elephants in Bandipur, and if you save elephants in Bandipur, there are other animals staying in Bandipur. There are small mammals, there are tigers, there are leopards, there are any animals, amphibians, reptiles, all these animals are going to get safe and protected. So that's the reason they are called umbrella species. And another ecological importance of elephant is they are seed disperser. Elephant tends to eat for 16 hours in wild, and they keep on defecating every 2 hours. So, and they keep on moving. So in the due course, they are also dispersing seed of multiple plants to different distances. So there are also studies have proven that there are, you know, plants which actually relies on elephant for germinating. And other than that, ecosystem engineer, you guys may have heard about savanna grassland. And many times, you know, elephant tend, when they are in forest, they tend to move a lot. They tend to break up branches. And there are, since they use the same route multiple times, there will be a trail formation. So it's kind of engineering inside the forest. They maintain the forest. And on the top, recent study, they showed that, you know, elephants are also microhabitat creator because they are very bulky. When they walk on the ground, sometimes there is impression created. And under that impression, there will be, it forms kind of forms like a puddle where multiple microorganisms and also small mammals or small animals are found on such kind of impression. So you can see that elephant has multiple ecological roles, and that's why it is important for us to study elephants. Well, now talking about the sad story that why it is important to study elephants. If you see the picture, can you guys see the picture? Right, there is a dim red if you can see the map. Are you guys able to see the map?
Yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so if you see the map is quite dim red section, and then you can see dark red patches. The dim red patch is actually the geographical range of elephants previously. So all this area there used to be Asian elephants, and now just see that elephants are restricted to small patches of forest or pockets of forest. And it is said that the distribution of elephants has reduced to 6% of their historical range, touching 13 countries. That means, you know, their habitat is declining rapidly, and that's why it is important for us to study elephants to know that you know how these things are hampering their population status, their ecological status, and also their behavior under the ecology and also conservation status. So beside this, bringing to you is a saddest story again. We talked about ecological role, we talked about habitat role, now conservation concern. Because you guys, now you might have seen that there are lots of news circulating about elephants, abuses, harassment, many people are getting divided, and that, you know, all these things are happening. So this is the country where elephants are also worshipped as Lord Ganesha, and in many captivity they are also harassed and abused, and you know, their natural behavior is prohibited. But And also in the fringes of forest, you can see adverse interaction between humans and elephant. And on the top of that, there is poaching going on for the ivory. And people have also started, you know, poaching elephants for skin. So all these factors that, you know, the interaction, the relationship between human and elephants urges us to study elephant. That's where it is important to know more about elephants, and also such kind of relationship that how it is influencing the behavior or, you know, ecology of elephants. So how we can study elephants? Now we know the reason, now we know what elephants are, why elephants are important, and how we can study elephants. If you see, if you just dig up the research, you can see there are multiple research on ecology of elephants, that their behavior, people study multiple behavior of elephants, and then also conflict management. When I say conflict, it's adverse interaction between human and elephants. So people have started studying about that, how to minimize such kind of adverse interaction. People are also studying population dynamics of Asian elephants. On the top, the new branch of science, which is, you know, people are now, they have started working on it, is physiology. And that's where I study the physiology of elephant, and particularly under the physiology, the branch of science is called wildlife endocrinology. So here I want to start, I want to take you all guys and take you guys to what I study, and why I study, and where I study, and what I found. This will be like brief journey for you guys, and you know, some of the scientific terms will be there, kindly bear it with. I won't go into the details, but whoever is interested to know more, they can contact me directly. So elephant human conflict. So when I came to India and when I got selected in Indian Institute of Science, there I was given a, you know, in IIC the best part is you have to come up with your questions. You have to find what you actually want to study, and that gives you the freedom, and that gives you, you know, lots of curiosity that gives you to address all the curiosity and question that you have in your mind. So when I came to India and I started seeing news about elephants killing human being, which is also quite common in Nepal, and elephant attacking humans, and in retaliation elephant being killed, and elephant being killed in railway station, railway collision, and elephant coming out of their habitat, and so many such news. So main reason behind all this adverse news is actually the India has 28,000 to 30,000 wild Asian elephants. That's a 60% of global Asian elephants in entire world, and the protected areas in India forms only 22% of elephant habitat. So the national parks we have supports only 22%, acts as a 22% of elephant habitat. That means rest of the elephants are actually either in human dominated landscape or either in reserve forest or sometimes outside the villages, you know. So that's where elephants and humans are sharing resources. Just imagine two powerful animal species, elephants and humans, sharing resources and space. That's where conflict begins. So to avoid the use of word conflict, I would like to term it as adverse human-elephant interactions. So there is rise in adverse human-elephant interaction. And I found that, you know, elephants in India, every year there is 100 elephants that die, and also 500 humans. This mortality rate is 500, so 500-200 human elephant ratio. They die in this adverse elephant human interaction. So I was really curious to know that how, you know, such kind of interaction is influencing the health or internal environment of animal, of elephant. What is happening to elephant in such kind of intense interactions? So that's where I thought of studying stress physiology. So stress physiology is so here I want to be very brief. If you guys have any queries, please write to me, okay? So stress physiology is nothing but a branch of science where we study the stress response. Since you guys are quite familiar with the term stress, you know, so there are lots of stressors or disturbance or perturbation or challenges in our ecosystem or in our environment. So when we perceive that, our body reacts towards those kind of stressors, that reaction is called a stress response. So stress response can be studied physiologically, psychologically, social, and you can study behaviorally. But I was more interested to understand the physiological. So what is exactly physiology? So I'll just take you briefly into it because we have limited time and we have to discuss more. So physiological stress response, when you perceive stress, you know, there is something called hypothalamus, pituitary gland, and adrenal. This pathway, HPA axis, get activated, and finally something called glucocorticoid stress hormone gets released. This glucocorticoids, which is also known as stress hormone, has multiple functions. It's not just for stress, but it has multiple functions. One of the functions is for stress. So this glucocorticoids, one gets released into the blood, it has negative feedback loop, and this cycle stops. But imagine that this animal is perceiving stress for a prolonged period, then this entire cycle gets disrupted, and that's where chronic stress happens, and that is what is detrimental for the health of elephant. So this is what I wanted to study. And now glucocorticoids, once it is in blood, it undergoes many kind of conjugation, deconjugation, metabolism, and finally gets excreted out as a fecal glucocorticoid metabolite. Just remember, fecal glucocorticoid metabolites is nothing but a metabolite of stress hormone in the feces, in the dung of elephant. So this is where, you know, I thought of studying the health of elephant, that how stresses, how adverse elephant human interaction is increasing this stress hormone in elephants. So with this, I studied in, for my PhD, I worked in the forest of Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, And during my postdoctoral research, I chose West Bengal. I studied in North Bengal, North and South. I studied the wild elephants. So one of the factors I want to tell you that stress hormone can be measured using blood sample. But I prefer using dung because, you know, if you collect the blood sample, first thing you are stressing that elephants. So that when you stress elephants, you are biasing your experiment. That's where I thought of using fecal sample. And this technique is called non-invasive technique. So I use non-invasive technique to study the health of elephants. So what exactly I used to do is in the forest is I used to follow elephants on foot and then identify each of the individuals. So you can see, you can identify elephant using the cut mark on the ears, the air venison pattern, the tusk orientation, the length of the tusk, and also sometime, you know, other features like tail haircut and all these features. So with this, I identify each of the individual. I observe them. I, you know, group their age class. There are four age class in elephants: adult, subadult, juvenile, and calf. So you note the age class. If you can also observe, when you are observing elephant, you can see if they are behaving differently. So once they defecate, once elephant defecate and move away, I used to collect the dung sample as fresh as I can. So I did multiple experiments and I found that the hormone, the stress hormone that I'm measuring remains intact for 6 to 9 hours. And that gave me, you know, more time to observe them without disturbing animal. So once I collect the sample, I used to bring them to lab. So I used to, in the field itself, I used to store them in mine, I used to freeze them and then bring it to lab, store the sample and extract them and finally analyze the hormone. There is a technique called ELISA. I won't go into detail, but like I said, whoever is interested, they can email me. And I'll be more than happy to share with you my publication and the protocol that I have created. Some elephant is not ethical and you are disturbed experiment, but I realized that collecting a dung rest and sample should be really fresh. So this is where, you know, I thought I should be more clever. So what I did was I did not just measure hormone. I also measured the age class if there is already established equation. I used that equation and I measured the age class of the elephants using the dung sample. I also measured the diet quality of elephants by measuring nitrogen level and carbon level in the dung sample. And also, you know, identify the sex of the individual, like using DNA tools and all this thing, particularly for the elephants, which were in the conflict area, where like in case of my PhD study, Hassan and Kurg. So in this case, I used to follow elephants at night. So I could not, many times I could not see the elephants, whether it's a male or a female. For those elephants, I used molecular sexing. So what I found was, this is the finding of my PhD, and I found that there are multiple factors that influence the stress response. It is human disturbance, seasonality, diet, presence of baby, group size, habitat, body fat, lactation. But this is, since there are only limited studies on wild Asian elephants, there are hardly 5 or 6 studies on wild Asian elephants so far. So our studies compromises most of them. So more is yet to be known. And that's where I'm continuing for my postdoc. I'm trying to understand more about stress hormone, how they behave differently, and there are other factors that I have included. So now we know that, you know, many times animals behave differently, but we never realize that there is something going on inside. There's chemical factors going on inside. Now we know that stress elephants also behave differently. So before doing all this study, we were just observing the behavior of animals. So we did not know why they are behaving differently. So I just want to give you one example. This is of a temple elephant. Many times you guys have noticed that elephant in temple keep on shaking, right? It's just keep on nodding. That is one of the stereotypic behavior because that elephant is stressed, highly stressed. So when they are stressed, that's a way of relieving stress. Now we know that what is going inside the elephants. Similarly, in case of human-dominated areas, or if I can call, and again, pardon me, the conflict area, many elephant, you know, they behave, they start walking rapidly, they will take refuge, they are sometimes they are aggressive, sometimes they're very scared. Now we know those elephants have higher stress level or low stress level, and other than stress hormone, there are other hormones like ghrelin, leptin, which are related to hunger and overeating. And also in case of elephants, there are reproductive hormones which has been already studied, testosterone, estrogen, progesterone. And now we know that interplays of all these chemicals are actually changing the behavior of animals, right? So that's where, you know, it's the beauty of science that you can now understand that inside the internal changes, animals are behaving differently. So that's what actually was the finding of my study. I was really interested to understand the internal environment of animals, and finally I found it. So before I end my talk, this news, most of you guys heard about the pregnant elephant who sadly passed away. And this is one of my images which also got viral over internet. So, you know, since you guys may have heard lots of adverse news circulating over internet since not just today or tomorrow or yesterday, but since many, many years and months. So that's where I want you guys to come forth, because elephants and other animals need more of us. They need more science. Because if you can see, you know, there are division happening, there are lots of conflict happening between our opinion. But if we have science, we can prove them that, you know, what actually is happening to the animal. And that's where I want to end my note, and I want to open for conversation. We can just have a question. I'm ready to go with the questions. And this is my request for you guys to never ride an elephant when you guys go for safari, because they have lots of traumatic trauma. With this, thank you so much, and I'll open the floor for the question now.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for this precious information about your life journey to the elephant land and effort toward your elephant love. Mm-hmm. And I really appreciate your painting, ma'am.
Thank you.
So I would like to call Mr. Ritik Adyan.
I'm sorry. So I was speaking very fast because I wanted to cover as much as topic I wanted to say to you guys. So pardon me if you guys are confused. Please write to me, okay? Please write to me if you guys want to know more about it. Ritik and Neeraj will share my email ID with you guys. And go ahead with questions.
Sure, Ritik.
Yes, everyone, if you want to ask some question, you can ask. There is one question from his question is that collect, we can ELISA technique, we can measure it by ELISA technique.
What I did not get it. What is that? I'm sorry.
Hello.
Yeah, sorry.
That dung contain particular marker or any hormone which is investigated by ELISA technique.
Yes. So I did not tell you the technique.
That is contained for a particular hormone. It is investigated by. It is in.
Yes. Yes, you're right. The dung, the hormone that is present in the dung sample, like I told you guys, I use ELISA technique to measure the hormone. And if you guys are really interested to know ELISA technique, we have developed that in IIC. I'm more than happy to discuss with you guys in person. I can see Aprajita has asked one question. She said, what about the recent incident that took place in Kerala, such a literate place? Well, this is not about literacy or these things. And you know, the death of elephants, it is occurring in India and other elephant raising country. It's just that yesterday the Kerala case was quite barbaric, and because we saw it visually ourselves, and that's why we can relate it. But it is, all the incidences are happening around the world, and not around the world, in the elephant ranging countries. And I'm really happy, you know, people are getting coming together to express their agony. But this agony should be channelized to find solution rather than, you know, with us. On killing a human, a person hanged, then what is the punishment for killing human elephants? Oh, well, there is no punishment right now. So I think, you know, Good. Somebody was speaking. Who was that, Riti?
Thank you, ma'am, for sharing your comments. I request everyone to please off your mic and video. You can ask your question in comment box. I will ask ma'am to answer that. Ma'am, there is a question from Abhija James. Is there any method discovered for controlling the aggressiveness in elephants through the behavior or physiological analysis?
Oh, so Abhija, nice question. Methods discovered for controlling the aggressiveness. Why should we control the aggressiveness in elephant? I really don't understand that. Why it is necessary? Because you can develop, there are certain hormones if you, you know, inject that to elephants. Yes, they may become less aggressive, but I think, you know, it's not ethical to control the aggressiveness. And why you want to control the aggressiveness? There are techniques, positive reinforcement technique, where using those you can actually control, not, I won't use the word control, you can, you know, make elephant less aggressive, particularly when they are in captivity. And there's one
thank you, ma'am, for answering. There's another question from what was the purpose of putting crackers in pineapple? Was it is any scientific experiment?
No, so I think this is by Anurag. So yeah, so this is, you know, if you guys go Google, there's something called Hakka Patas. So they, in Sri Lanka, they use that technique. I have also written a story about it. I am a cartoonist, so I have made a blog to spread knowledge about elephants. And through that, in that blog, you can find one of the story called Hakka Patas, where they actually instill crackers inside the vegetable to actually scare away the wild bird. So it is a way of mitigating the conflict, but it's not a sustainable way of mitigating, because it has lots of harm for other animals as well. So elephant happened to eat that pineapple, and yeah, that's what we came to know, the sad story. Yes, and it's not a scientific experiment, no. It's how people have come up with their own technique. Yeah, Ritik. What kind of questions?
Mr. Anu Sharma, what kind of questions one can do? Questions one can do pursue in conflict between humans and animals.
One second, your voice is breaking. Let me connect to Wi-Fi. Or am I able to? Am I audible to you guys? You guys are able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Without breaking. Awesome. So, what kind of questions one can do pursue between humans?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So to Anur, I want to give an example of yesterday case in Kerala. You guys might have come across the case, and you know that's where we need more scientists to come in to come up with a more sustainable solution. And there are lots of questions, conflict between humans and animals. You can study about, you know, behavioral change in animals when they are in conflict. I don't want to use the term conflict, the negative interaction. You can study about how much loss humans are facing, or how much, you know, what kind of physiological change animals are going through, and what kind of mitigation measures one can develop. So there are lots of questions. If you start reading about it, many questions will come to you.
Ma'am, next question from Janani Shangumun. Question is, which compound marks the tracks of elephant that is identified from dung?
Wonderful question. So we actually use DNA. It's not compound. So we use DNA to mark the sex of the individual. And that's what I did with dung. If you guys heard my presentation, I heard my presentation. I collected dung sample to measure the hormone and also to, you know, measure the DNA to measure the identify the sex of the individual. So you measure DNA. You don't measure the compound. You measure the DNA.
So the next question from ma'am are Aprijita Singh. Mm-hmm. So her question is, so is there any law for hunting and poaching these animal locally, or the if IFS officers pass exam mugging having no intention for protection and other?
No, say repeat again, Neeraj, repeat it again.
So is there any law for hunting and poaching of these animals locally, or the IFS officers pass exam mugging, having no intention for protection and other?
So it's I understand the agony, I understand the aggression you guys have, but IFS exam, you know, I don't want to talk about that, IFS officers and all this thing. But regarding the law and hunting and against poaching, if you guys, since I'm pretty sure most of you guys are from environmental science, and we study the law, right? Wildlife Protection Act. I think you in this semester, or I don't know, in the fourth semester somewhere, you guys are going to study about, there are rules against all these hunting and poaching. Sometimes people do not follow it. You know, sometimes all these adversities are there, but we do, India do have strong rules and regulation.
Ma'am, next question from Vishal Sharma. He just wanted to ask, ma'am, what's your thought about the Project Elephant in India? It's falling as the population is left only 20,000. Last year, it was around 30,000. And there are only 6% habitat for elephant. It's worrying. From 1992, we manage only this, failure of government agency.
Okay, I did. This is really good concern of Vishal. I really appreciate that. But I don't think, you know, Project Elephant is failing anywhere. And if you follow the trend of population of elephants in India, it's not declining. It's stable. It's not declining at all. And other thing he asked was 6% of habitat. There are only 6%. I think it's not correct. It's not 6% of habitat. I would really appreciate if Vishal can send me where he got this detail from. So, but I must appreciate that, you know, wildlife activities or wildlife study or wildlife management and policy in India, some of the policies, you know, people may have taken it lightly, but they are really strong. They're extremely, and that's the reason, you know, India, because rules and regulations are really good here.
And then next question from Mohit Kumar. I just want to ask from you, ma'am, is there any genetic basis for presence or absence of tusks?
No. I was expecting this question, and thank you, Mohit, for, you know, I'm really happy that you guys are thinking about all these questions. So in our lab, Professor Sukumar is also known as Elephant Man of India, and his lab is dedicated to study elephants. And in our lab, our research team, I'm not working on that, but our research team is working to find that why there is tusker and why there is makhna. Now, why there's such kind of genetic, is it because of genetic variation that there is no tusk in makhna? So that is one of the major questions that our lab is addressing. So we do not have answer right now.
I have one more question.
Next question from
Okay,
Danny. Are the tamed ones loyal to the master? Are the tamed
Can you be a bit louder?
Are the tamed ones loyal to the master? Tamed, ma'am.
Mohit, your voice is breaking. Can you do one thing? Can you type your question? I'll just
I request Mr. Mohit Kumar to please turn off your mic and ask in comment box.
Comment, please. Yes. What about career and opportunity in wildlife in India at present? Anuj Sharma. So to answer to Anuj, there are immense potentiality in this career, and it's more about not just career, you know, it's kind of duty that you are doing for the nature. And like I said, that we need more science, the thing that is circulating over internet, people are just commenting with agony. I understand emotion, but if it is backed up with science, then it becomes more strong. And since somebody right now said that, you know, policy is declining and all this, Vishal said that policy is declining and what is happening, are we failing? So that is also a good question, but what is our contribution to wildlife? So that's where, you know, I think yes, there is very good opportunity if you can do really good in wildlife science. There are many opportunities.
Thank you, ma'am. One question from my side, ma'am.
All right, Neeraj. Yeah, go ahead.
What's your message for all the listeners on the World Environment Day?
Well, when you wrote to me 2-3 days back, and since there was that pregnancy, pregnant elephant died, and I was really sad. And I was a little emotional, and I wrote about it on my Facebook profile. And then, but now, since you understand, you know, somewhere, some point of time, we are lacking something. We are not able to protect elephants or other animals. Even if we keep on fighting over internet, Twitter, and all this thing, even if we keep on writing, doing some research, publishing it, but how that is going to go to the ground level? And that's where, you know, I want you guys to come up. You guys are, I am pretty sure, you know, you guys should come. And because and like I said, that I can see that the way you guys are questioning, you know, you guys have that thought process, and I want you guys to come back to science, and you are in science, but to wildlife science and other science, to actually make a difference in society. And in this World Environment Day, many animals need you. They need you to be their voice through science. So that is my message for you guys.
Yes, ma'am. And the last question from Vishal Sharma. He just wanted to ask that please talk about your Bhunta elephant. What elephant? He just want to ask about your elephant. Vishal Sharma.
Oh, Vishal, yeah. Thanks, Vishal, for getting interested in Bhunta. So, Bhunta, in 2016, when I was following, 2015, when I was following elephant in the forest, and I saw a baby elephant. I think I kept that picture in my presentation as well. And I was really inspired by the cuteness. And then I thought, you know, many times that cuteness factor can change your mindset. And that's where, you know, I thought I should start cartoon. And I love drawings. I am a poet. I write poetry. And I thought, why can't I use cartoon in, you know, as a form of awareness and as a form of campaign to protect elephant, or to sensitize people about elephant. And that's where I started Bhunta in 2016. My main motive was to only grab the attention of kids. But you guys won't believe, I'm really happy, you know, there are more adults reading Bhunta, and it has traveled all across around 110 countries, more than that. So there are readers from 110 countries studying, you know, reading about Bhunta. Even though my cartoons are very trivial, it's not like professional cartoons. But with that, I want you guys also to get inspired, you know, because you guys may be having some other quality in you, like in hobby, as hobby. If you can use that hobby to sensitize, to aware, you know, correctly, it can be really good. You can make a video, you can make a blog or start writing, or you start drawing or poetry, something, you know, to sensitize or to use science, to communicate science. And
yes, ma'am. I would like to call Ritik Kadyan. So please put on the microphone of Mr. Mohit Kumar. He just really want to ask.
Mohit, I think he, Anurag, before Mohit has question.
He can himself open his mic.
Mohit Kumar. One second. I think Anurag has a question. Anurag, is female more attracted to tusked male than tuskless makhna? Does tusk have any role in sexual selection? Wonderful question. That is very very good question. And one of my seniors, he did research on it. He did a PhD. I'm getting lots of disturbance. I think Ritik, you should. I think this is from Ritik's side. So yeah. So she did a PhD on that, whether the tusk is used as an ornament, but she found that it is not used as an ornament. She studied the male female choice behavior in elephants, mating choice, and then she found that, you know, male, which are larger in body size and which are in musk, are females are more attracted to them than to the tusk. Now coming to Mohit. Mohit said recently you said we can differentiate gender on the basis of DNA. You are saying in terms of cryotyping, if cryotyping, then it is very expensive. Is it possible for large number of samples? No, actually the one I do through PCR. And it's very cheap. It's not expensive. Molecular sexing is very basic now. Genetic field of genetic is quite advanced. There are lots of technique that has developed, and the one I did hardly cost around 80,000 for me to do. So I did around 100 to 200 samples, because those elephants were the elephants which I sighted during night time. So it's very cheap now. Can you please share your email ID? I'd request Neeraj and Ritik to do that. They can say, sure. Answer me. Sophie had a question. What question Sophie had? Are the tame ones loyal to the masters? Wow, Sophie, that's a really good question. And the taming of elephant is really, it's really hard to observe, because these elephants are they are actually harassed, and they go. So there are two ways of taming the elephants. If you see the captivity, one is through negative reinforcement and positive reinforcement. Most of the time it's negative reinforcement that is used, and where elephants are literally, if you see that, you will never ever support elephant in captivity. And once they become submissive, they are loyal to the mahout, and their masters are known as mahout. They are loyal. In India, which national park sanctuary has largest number of elephants? Karnataka has largest number of elephants. We have 7,000 elephants, I think. Karnataka and Assam. Ma'am, what about the career opportunity in, I think I already answered that question. What else we have? Sunil Chopra, Karbi Anglong, Rumora River area of Assam, including Kaziranga, is home to largest number of elephants. Yes, good. And what, but sometimes PCR also give false result. Yes, that's where, Mohit, we need to do repeatedly. In IC, if you come to IC, I can show you to guys that, the DNA genetic analysis lab is very sophisticated, and many times we repeat. It's not only once. So what we do is we analyze the molecular sexing of identify individual first, for whom our sex, we know the sex, and then we do for those which are not identified. So there are ways. We replicate the experiments. We don't just do once. I think any more questions?
Ma'am, I think Mohit want to ask the last question. Are you doing in triplicate?
Yes. We do in triplicate, not any triplicate. That's what I was saying. We repeat the experiment until and unless we are sure that whatever we are getting is actually a true. It's a true result.
I think the question is going to too long.
Neeraj, I want Neeraj, one last question.
Yes.
Do elephants have any medical importance other than their ecological importance?
Medical importance, like what? Like if Abhija can be more clear, what is medical importance? If I have to make I can make a link. So elephants do have a medical importance because they help in dispersing some of the medicinal plant and which we use for medicinal purposes. But I exactly do not know what medicinal importance elephant will have. They have a medical. I'm sorry, I did not understand the context of that. So now, before I end, Neeraj, can you tell me who are from IES?
Let me bind up the session. So I would like to thank you again, ma'am, for giving your precious time. Thank you very much, ma'am. So I would like to call Ritika Dan.
One second, Neeraj, see, wrote. Ma'am, the extraction of dung is found to be having medical properties. Medicinal dung. Okay, you meant dung. Well, nobody, to my knowledge, I may be wrong, nobody has studied the medicinal properties of dung. So I won't be able to answer that. I'm really sorry, Abhi sir.
Thank you, ma'am, for answering the questions. And I would like to say thank you to you and all our colleagues who joined this webinar. It was such, it was such a wonderful webinar. And I would like to request all the students of Kurukshetra University to stay here and we can rest and leave the webinar.
So those who are from Kurukshetra can stay and those who are not can leave. That's what he wants to say.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Only the students from
Kurukshetra. I would like to request Bahariya ma'am also to stay here only.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for this wonderful seminar. I didn't too much information I have today. Ask about the too many names you named the elephant, like Bhutte, Michael Das.
I know.
Yes, ma'am.
I feel really happy to talk to you guys, and so many times I'm really interested to talk about elephants. So thanks.